talking about what happened when I was first taken in. What prompted me being taken in was Robert ringing the Royal Park Hospital, or ringing the CAT team, I'm not sure which, but the CAT team at the Junction Clinic was run as an outpatient clinic of the Royal Park Hospital at that stage. And the now is run by the Alfred Hospital. At that time, the Alfred and the Royal Park were connected through the University of Melbourne. Now the Alfred Hospital is connected with Monash University and Monash Medical Center. Anyway, I'll cut to the chase.
It's all right.
Well, what happened is that the CAT team came around. Robert had reported that I had smashed up the flats, which was not true, but there were some renovations being done in the, well, actually they were fixing up the cold water tap in the bathroom. So there was some wood on the floor, and the story that was written in the discharge summary, which is probably the best way of explaining the way it was perceived by the Royal Park Hospital. It gives you some idea that the admission date was 7th of April, 1995. Discharge date was 10th of May, 1995. However, that included, as you'll see, a break when I escaped the first time from Royal Park, and then was returned to Royal Park and kept there for another 2 weeks. The first admission to Royal Park really was only 2 or 3 days, and then I just walked out of the hospital, not realizing what the legal situation was. That I meant then that the matter gets referred to the police, and the police are under orders to return me to the hospital. I didn't really know much about the psychiatric system in Victoria, because I'd graduated in Queensland and then gone down as a general practitioner and worked in solo general practice. I'd never ever committed a patient. I'd never diagnosed a person with schizophrenia. I would just continue hospital treatment, and if somebody was suicidal, I'd think that they needed to go to hospital, but I never forced anyone to do that. So I didn't really know what the laws were. Mm-hmm. Anyway, what happened is that really once I had been referred into the psychiatric system 3 weeks earlier, I was then already part of the system. I was in there, their computer records. So when they got a call that one of their patients, or one of Rajan Thomas's patients, had become psychotic, they just sent the CAT team around, which they asked me, will you take clonazepam, which is a tranquilizer? I said no, and I said okay, and they just walked out, and they came back about an hour later with police and handcuffed me and took me away to Royal Park. When I went to Royal Park, by that time, the police were rude to me, and I was quite offhand with them as well, but they threatened me and called me a black bastard, one of them threatened to punch me. He didn't punch me, but they handcuffed me. I was really angry because I wasn't used to being treated like that. So when I was taken into the Royal Park, the assessment area, I demanded to see a senior doctor, and I mean I demanded. And I just got a resident who has initially wrote that I was a 23-year-old medical student. Now I was a 34-year-old doctor criticizing the system, not a 23-year-old medical student. Even so, I don't think a 23-year-old medical student should have been committed for saying the kind of things that I was saying. But it's quite different if a person's got 7 years experience in general practice criticizing the psychiatric model, which is what I was doing. I was criticizing both the attention deficit disorder label and the autism label at that stage, and also the schizophrenia model. And specifically the drugs used to treat them. So, recall at that time, also, I should say, I was quite influenced by Buddhism, and I was really, in fact, strongly influenced by Buddhist philosophy, which I sort of rediscovered. I'd been interested in Buddhist philosophy maybe for 15 years before, but I actually got quite seriously into reading about Buddhist philosophy, and I regarded myself at that stage as having had something of a Buddhist conversion. And this was very disturbing to my family, who were Anglican Christian, and also resulted in me being my ideas misconstrued. As I said, I was having lots of insights at that time, and the term insight and having things coming together and seeming that all the things that I had learnt in the past war coming together, I saw it as filling in the gaps. These gaps in my knowledge, these are described as classic symptoms of hypomania and mania. The point is, though, that other features like overspending, sexual indiscretions, lack, reduced need for sleep, these were all, they are all listed as signs of mania and hypomania, and they were retrospectively applied to me even if they didn't occur. Not sexual indiscretions, but overspending. And I'll read this discharge summary because it's quite brief, and it gives you some idea of how they assessed me, or the registrar, Jan Theobald, assessed me after talking to me once. Maybe, I don't think she even spoke to me by herself, just with the consultant. 34-year-old general practitioner of Sri Lankan background, admitted as involuntary patient because of hypomania. No previous psychiatric history. History of present illness. Approximately 4 months prior to admission, which ties in exactly with the time that I separated from Sue. Romesh developed a decreased need for sleep, elevated affect, and frenetic activity. Now, I didn't say this. I had separated from my ex-wife, so she couldn't have said that. So it was obviously said by someone who didn't have anything to do with me, because Robert and my sister didn't have anything to do with me much in that 4 months. However, it's true that I would have said that I had a reduced need for sleep, because I wasn't making a secret of it. However, elevated affect, which means I had an elevated mood, and frenetic activity. I was very active, but my work and my ideas were not frenetic, as in frenetic, as in haphazard or in a great hurry. In fact, I was talking about efficiency and increasing efficiency by not being in a hurry. At this time, he began neglecting his medical practice, which was not true, and I can get to that. He stated to relatives he had a revelation, inverted commas, like Buddha, in which he became aware of the oneness of all living things. Mm-hmm. Now, that's a clear indication that this did come from members of my family, and I never said anything to my father about having a revelation, revelations or insights.
There's nothing wrong with that.
Nothing wrong with that. And when they say like Buddha, it is the Buddha who talked a lot about the oneness of all living things. So having an insight similar to what the Buddha's insight on that matter is not saying that one is a Buddha or one is enlightened in the same way. It's just that one had a similar insight. And began haranguing friends and relatives about this incessantly. Now, Sarah, you were a friend at that time. Would you regard that I was haranguing you or my other friends about my insight about the oneness of living things like the Buddha?
No, I don't recall that. I knew you for a short period before then.
Yeah.
So, I would say that that I suppose at that particular time there was so much going on.
No, what was going on? What do you mean so much going on?
Well, I guess there was so much going on in the sense for you, many changes. Right? You were discovering, not just discovering, but maybe, as you said, that filling in the gaps, piecing the puzzle together.
Yeah.
Integrating, doing a lot of integrating of Eastern philosophies and with, I guess, your own
ideas.
Yeah, and your own training.
Okay, my own specific training. I was broadening my ideas, you'd say?
I would say so, yes. And let me...
But what was my behavior like? I mean, did I talk over people, or...?
I would say that you were talking a lot.
More than when you first met me?
I think you were sort of speeding, I suppose, in your thoughts. Your thoughts were racing, I guess.
Yeah.
And, but not always.
And how much? Okay, I'll ask, a candid question.
Yeah.
Right? How much do you think ganja had to do with it?
Okay. I was smoking myself, so... in retrospect, I think ganja has a lot to do with having insights and having thoughts racing and speeding, as well as having the opposite effect as well at times.
Yeah.
It can, make you quite vague.
But you don't smoke now, right? Okay, you haven't since you've been pregnant,
no.
Right? How different do you think your thinking has been?
Well,
you were speeding last week with your work on the Pioneer or research in the Pioneer.
Yeah, I really don't know. I think personally, obviously, it has to do with your own frame of mind when you're smoking. And, yeah, all those feelings or whatever you're thinking is, I suppose, accentuated. You feel them more intensely, maybe.
Okay, so do you think that back in 95, right, you say that I was more talkative than I was in 93 when you met me? Mind you,
you
also knew me.
You were always talkative.
I was always talkative.
You were always talkative, I'd say.
And do you think there was a sudden change in the kind of things I was talking about?
No, I would just say that, new ideas that were coming to you, you were, particularly excited about.
Yeah, okay.
Ugh.
And do you think that my ideas were crazy? Did you at that time, and do you in retrospect?
Shall I be totally candid?
Yeah, be candid. Yeah, we'll be
edgy, so. Okay. Oh, yeah. All right. There were some things that I thought...
were a bit strange.
Yeah.
Right.
But,
You're talking about me thinking that I was the second coming.
Yeah. Mind you... entertained the possibility that I was the woman who was going to give birth to the second coming, so... I think a lot of people come to the conclusion that they might be the saviour.
Yeah.
Of
humanity.
Of
yeah.
humanity.
Right, okay.
I mean, you know, it's nice to be a hero.
And do you think that what I'll cut to the chase, because you also saw me immediately, you saw me in hospital as well.
Yeah.
Right? What was I like in hospital?
What were you like?
Yeah. Can you describe what I was like? What my behavior was like when I was in hospital? What I seemed like?
The very first time?
Yeah, the first time in Royal Park when you went in there.
I think you were a little bit distressed, I suppose. You know, like you just wanted to get out of there and thinking what's going on. But nothing unusual or anything.
I didn't seem... What did I look like? Did I seem slow? Did I seem...
No, not initially.
Right.
I don't think.
You didn't notice it in Royal Park? Because my mother has written about what it was like. In Royal Park. But you didn't see me much in Royal Park because you only really came when you came, the second time you came around, I escaped with you.
I don't think I saw much of the... Are you talking about the drug effect?
Yeah. Yeah. Did I seem drugged or did other people seem drugged?
Oh, my God. I think at Royal Park, at some stage you did, but maybe not initially because you were, you know, there were some times when you weren't so drugged up, but there were, after the drugs had set in.
Yeah.
Yes.
And what were the drug effects that you noticed?
Like a mask across the face.
Yeah. So I wasn't reacting. My face wasn't reacting.
No, it's almost like the eyes were glazed.
Right, yes. Okay.
Speech was slowed.
Yeah.
Movements stiff or stiff.
Yeah.
I think the very first time I went to Royal Park I was really disturbed because I saw a few patients. One of them was a lady who was being, I think, walked like arm in arm with a nurse who was just shuffling her feet, walking.
Yeah.
And there was one other guy who was sitting on a chair and his head and eyes were rolling back.
Yeah. And what about in 96 after Monash?
Yeah, there was people who were quite drugged up.
Yeah, what about me, when I came out of Monash?
Oh, yeah, when you came out of Monash, it was like the life had been sucked out of you, I think. So I could describe it.
How would you describe, what was your perspective of what happened in Monash in 96?
Monash.
You went away after I got locked up.
The first time, yes.
Yeah, you went away. The cops came around to your house, right?
The first time? Oh, after
yeah, when
you
I escaped
sketched.
From Royal Park. Yeah.
Yes.
And?
They asked me.
Where I was?
Yes.
You said you didn't know?
Yes.
And? Yeah. And then? You went away.
They went away, I went away.
Yeah, and you came, you came back.
I came back.
In what, December or so?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah.
And what was I like then?
Oh, very, you know, you had been quite productive. You were writing, I think, about, you'd just written your...
My first book.
Your first book, Alpha State.
Yeah.
Which I didn't really read. But I was impressed that you had written a book. You were good.
And then how come I got locked up again in 96? Did you think there was anything weird about how I was behaving?
No, not at all. Not at that stage, no. The only thing that used to get me kind of like, oh God, is when you were speaking to your mother on the phone.
Yeah.
And you were very angry.
Yeah.
And I think that was perceived as part of your madness or something at that stage.
Yeah.
From the family's point of view.
Yeah.
Mm. And then I guess that time, that was I think the first time after I'd come back that you got locked up again, when
yeah.
the cat team just arrived out of nowhere.
Yeah.
And they said they were taking you in.
Yeah.
We were thinking, well, why?
Yeah.
Something strange going on. And I remember
the social...
speaking to the policeman and then I...
The social worker, Ruth Lockton.
Yes, and then I said to her, I asked her, what's going on? Why are you taking him? Is he, it's fine, everything's fine. And then that's when she's told me that, you know, you're deluded because you believe that you have your medical registration and you don't. And of course, that cast doubt in my mind at that point.
Yeah.
It's like, I'm not sure if whether this is true or not true or...
But you are sure now.
Oh, as soon as you'd gone into hospital, I looked through you had like a...
Yeah.
One of those plastic folders with all the letters in it.
Yeah.
And I'd seen that you had been given back your medical registration.
Yeah.
And that this...
And when they realised their mistake?
What did they say?
Well, they said that wasn't the only reason I was mad.
No. No. Because you didn't have... insight into your madness.
Because I refused to accept that I had bipolar disorder.
Right, so it had gone from...
Hypomania
to...
In between, when I when I escaped from Royal Park
yeah.
and went up to Queensland,
yes.
the admission notes here, okay, I'll turn back to me.
That's cool, thank you.
I was reading about I'll finish off doing the discharge summary. Stay on that topic. Because right? I did ask you about whether I was haranguing my friends incessantly, and you answered it. But he referred, this is me, referred to a complex series of ideas, which he referred to as the Bioblos. And the chaotic theory of time, which made no sense to relatives. Okay. Now, you're laughing, Sarah, because?
Well, made no sense to relatives.
Which relatives do you think would have had difficulty with my discussing of the bioblob and chaos theory? My mother had no difficulty with me discussing the bioblob because it's the four-dimensional bioblob is just a biological theory of the interconnectedness of all life. Yeah? Chaos theory, of course, is a well-known physics theory.
Yeah.
But I think the only person who really got annoyed about it was Robert. I didn't discuss the bioblob or chaos theory with my father.
You discussed it with Robert?
Oh, yes. I was discussing the bioblob in 1992.
Yeah.
When I first discovered it, when I read it in the book called Riversley on paleontology discoveries. Yeah. Chaos theory, I had some theories about chaos and the aesthetic and how a chaotic aesthetic is really just a natural aesthetic because as I understood, my simple idea, non-mathematical idea of chaos theory, is that systems of order develop out of systems of chaos. It may have made no sense to relatives, but we're really... Robert did describe himself subsequently as my brother-in-law, and therefore a relative. But on the admission notes, which I have, he referred me in it's filled in that he was my next of kin as well as my treating doctor, which he was neither. So I think that that's very relevant. Anyway, it says he abolished regular hours and appointments in his practice, which is true, and claimed to be able to diagnose patients' problems instantly on sight without need for proper history and examination. That is so libelous because it destroyed my credibility as a doctor and made the medical practitioners board very concerned about me, as they would reasonably do. If I thought that I could diagnose patients' problems instantly on sight without a proper history and examination, I never did that. And of course, all doctors make spot diagnoses, which is just being able to diagnose, say, a person who's hypothyroid or hyperthyroid or suffering from Cushing's disease, a range of different problems by sight. But that is, that's good medicine. Not taking a proper history and examination is the opposite of the way I practice medicine. He attempted to give away his practice gratis to his locum, which is not true. I had employed a locum, by the way, because I was recording bands, as I said, after setting up this recording company, Groovon. I paid my employees, even though it says that I failed to pay my employees in the weeks leading up to their admission, and had omitted to pay his rent, taxation, and superannuation commitments. Now, this really just means that Robert went through all my notes, all my practice records with no authority. He had the cooperation of my ex-wife, but that's not a good enough reason for him to be going through and making all these false claims. He was spending uncharacteristically large amounts of money on books. I actually spent $600, and again, that is just from him looking at my MasterCard payments. And $600 on medical textbooks is not a lot of money. In fact, they weren't all medical textbooks. I bought about 20 books, and that's perfectly reasonable for me seriously wanting to do the research I was trying to do. That included Oliver Sacks's books. Referred to Inner South Community Mental Health Clinic and CAP by family. Refused community treatment. So that's basically the history of the present illness as presented in the Royal Park Summary.
And you were given a diagnosis of hypomania.
Yeah, it says, first of all, I'll mention the personal history. Family history, parents alive and well living in Queensland, Sri Lankan, Christian. Now, I'm actually born in England and I was Australian citizen. So
and there wasn't a very rigorous sort of
history taking by Dr. Jan Theobald, the registrar. Christian, one sister, apparently no family history of psychiatric illness. Basically, her whole history of present illness was taken directly from the admission notes by a different doctor.
Yeah.
Right, who thought I was a 23-year-old medical student. When I pointed that out, they went back and recorrected their notes, rewrote them, saying I was 34 years old. However, it is actually admitted in a letter from the chief psychiatrist when I complained about it, but that it in no way affected their diagnosis. So it says, personal history, Sri Lankan origin, brought up as Christian, but recent conversion to Buddhism, graduated from medical school in 1983 and has been practicing as a GP in Dandenong for the last 10 years. Father is a doctor, sister of plastic surgeon, brother-in-law, psychiatry registrar. The thing that's funny about that you can see in the on a slide, doctor, plastic surgeon are all in simple letters. Psychiatry registrar, which is what Jan Theobald is written in capitals, capital P, capital R.
Superior profession.
Superior profession, evidently. Married with 2-year-old daughter, but currently separated from wife Sue. Apparently, recent use of marijuana. It wasn't recent use, I've been using marijuana, or smoking marijuana, since I was a medical student aged about 21. Patient not prepared to divulge any personal information. I did say that to the initial treating, the initial resident. As I said, I demanded to speak to a senior doctor.
Uh-huh.
So I said, I'm not going to talk to you. I want to speak to a senior doctor. So she has taken that initial notes and then written it up 5 weeks later, as if that's how I behaved all the time I was in there. I was very keen when I was in there to talk to anyone who was going to try and find out what had actually happened, because I actually thought it was just a tragic and silly case of a mistake. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Past psychiatric history? No past psychiatric history. Mental state examination. So here it is, writing what my mental state examination was like in the hospital. Short man, average build, Sri Lankan origin. Casually dressed in shirt and trousers, wearing no shoes. That's because they took me from my house and they wouldn't let me put my shoes on, because they handcuffed me. No psychomotor agitation and able to sit during interview.
Mm-hmm.
Quite irritable and expansive mood.
Mm-hmm.
An expansive mood is a person who is in a mood like I always am in, where if you give me a topic, I'm happy to expand on it.
Well, you have a lot that you've got in... you're always expansive.
Yeah. Well, an expansive mood is considered to be a symptom of hypomania and mania. Three types of mood: irritable, expansive, or elevated. I say expansive and elevated are both healthy, normal moods.
Sure. Expansive is having a lot of knowledge.
Yeah.
And what was the other one?
Elevated.
Elevated is being happy.
Mm-hmm. Right. So at that time I was irritated with them, so that makes me have an irritable mood and an expansive mood, because I'm always expansive in the way I... And it's not a mood.
It's
a way
an
of
emotion.
Being. Yeah. Orientated by three. Orientated by three means time, person and place. I knew who I was, I knew where I was, and I knew when it was. Memory good. Denies disorders of perception, so I wasn't hallucinating. Three, speech pressured with flight of ideas. Physical examination. Patient refused physical examination. That was only the first time I went in. No obvious abnormality. Patient refuses blood tests. Provisional diagnosis, hypomanic episode.
Mm.
Treatment and progress. Started 2 days after admission on haloperidol and clonazepam.
Mm.
Now that seems like a lot of treatment for a guy who's not actually... You know, no psychomotor agitation, able to sit during interview with normal perception, good memory.
For
and I all I had is slight flight of ideas, yes. Slightly annoyed that I've been taken away from a very, very enjoyable life. After promising to remain on the ward, absconded 4 days after admission, he travelled to Canberra, where he caused a disturbance by attempting to see Barry Jones and Carmen Lawrence.
Mm.
Regarding the implementation of his medical theories. Yes, sorry, you...
Oh, no, I was just going to say, at that point, I think you should mention the fact that hypomania does not require hospitalization or medication. Is that correct? In according to the textbooks, they don't actually see it as a...
Well, this is... Yes, I'll it's true that hypomania... According to the DSM-4,
yes.
Hypomania is not accompanied by psychosis and does not require hospitalization. That's according to the DSM-4. It is common practice in Australia and probably in England, and I wouldn't be surprised in the USA as well, that they use the term hypomania as a mild form of mania. Sorry, I'm trying to find the thing, but it's not here. Okay, well, the DSM-4 says that hypomania can be accompanied by an increase in creativity, efficiency, or accomplishments in some people,
mm-hmm.
and is not accompanied by significant occupational or social dysfunction or problems.
Right.
Mania is accompanied by psychosis and will require hospitalization because there's a significant interference with social or professional and performance, and also accompanied by psychosis. So it's quite true that according to the DSM-4, hypomania does not justify hospitalization, and also does not justify antipsychotic drugs, and haloperidol is an antipsychotic drug.
Yeah.
Standard practice in Australia is to drug people with hypomania, even according to Australian textbooks.
It is.
It is. And right. An example of that is here in Foundations of Clinical Psychiatry, which is the textbook, 1994, coincided with the DSM-4.
Okay.
1994, and this replaced a previous textbook for Melbourne University and Monash University,
mm-hmm.
and it's published by Melbourne University Press,
mm-hmm.
Edited by Sydney Block and Bruce Singh. And this says, I'll say what, tell you what it says about hypomania. Hypomania. This is the standard text, by the way, for medical students,
mm-hmm.
in Victoria, 129 and 144. Mm-hmm. Okay, this is very important, I suppose, because all the students what they're training. Abnormal states of mood elevation. Far less commonly, this is under in a chapter 9, Mood Disorders by Izzy Schweitzer.
Mm-hmm.
Abnormal states of mood elevation. Far less commonly, this is rather than depression, far less commonly than depression, a persistent elevated mood occurs. Similarly, a continuum of severity is found with the mild states difficult to distinguish from normality, moderate severity hypomania, or severe state mania are obvious, the patient's behavior having serious consequences if treatment is not swiftly initiated.
Right.
Most manic patients also experience depressive swings, and this condition is therefore referred to as bipolar mood disorder. The rest of this section is about depression,
mm-hmm.
and then it says here management of elevated mood states.
Mm-hmm.
The assessment and treatment of the patient suffering from acute hypomania or mania is essentially the management of acute psychotic patient, acutely psychotic patient. Organic conditions, including drug-induced states, need to be excluded. For reasons of safety, most patients need hospitalization, which, because of the lack of insight, may need to be recommended. Recommended is another euphemism for sectioned or committed.
Yeah.
The mainstay of pharmacotherapy are the neuroleptics, such as haloperidol or chlorpromazine, which is largactil. Although lithium carbonate is an effective anti-manic agent, at relatively high concentrations, risks of toxicity discourage its use. Occasionally, for particularly severe cases, ECT is needed. In the long term, most patients with bipolar mood disorder receive prophylactic treatment with lithium carbonate. It is effective in preventing relapses of both elation and depression in up to 80% of patients. Recently, carbamazepine, or Tegretol, which is an epileptic drug, has also proved effective in prophylaxis and may therefore be substituted if lithium fails or causes excessive side effects. Lithium prophylaxis may also be appropriate for patients with cyclothymic disorder if symptoms are disabling. Cyclothymic disorder is people with big mood swings who don't actually qualify for as bad as manic depression,
oh.
right, or bipolar disorder. So basically...
So their argument is somebody who is hypomanic, it's sort of like a preventative measure. You just treat them sort of like with the same drugs, because eventually if you don't, they will become either manic and then probably bipolar.
That's right. They say that basically that that hypomania will tends to worsen and then become mania.
Mm-hmm.
So really anyone who's excited is eventually gonna go mad, so you gotta get onto them quickly before they get excited.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's the first sign of excitement. And or creative activity,
mm-hmm.
or original thinking, or really any change of elevation, or if they improve their mood, if their mood improves. It's extraordinary that this could, can you imagine the havoc this must be wreaking in the world, this mentality. It's been going for 15 years. No wonder depression is increasing in society. It's the only one that's
certainly,
really allowed.
You'd certainly get depressed if you were diagnosed and given drug treatment for being creative and...
Motivated.
Motivated, yes.
Driven. In fact, they say increase in goal-directed activities is a pathological symptom of hypomania.
It's a self-fulfilling
prophecy. It's a self-fulfilling prophecy, of course, yeah. Like, there is a little bit more, actually, and this is clinical features of mood elevation. They give a case example, and you'll probably relate to this, Sarah, because a 28-year-old single teacher was recommended by the physically assaulted the principal. He had been confronted following reports that he had been sexually propositioning several female students.
Mm-hmm.
He had recently purchased an expensive car that he could not afford and had been announcing plans of overseas travel and lectureships at prestigious universities. On admission, he was hostile, overreactive, and grandiose. He spoke of having important political contacts and of issuing Supreme Court writs. At times his speech was so rapid that it was barely intelligible. He had never been ill before, but his mother had been psychiatrically hospitalized soon after the birth of a younger brother. The patient was treated with haloperidol and made a full recovery within 3 weeks, but unfortunately was sacked from his job. Now this is a case example, right? This is a fictional case example.
Yeah.
So it's basically, this is your stereotype that you've got to work
firstly,
with.
Firstly, let's just take the first point. He bought a car that he could not afford. Isn't that practically 90% of the Australian population?
Purchasing an expensive car that he can't afford. Yes,
doesn't
indeed.
Everyone do that?
Indeed.
Apart from me.
Okay. So he had been sexually propositional several female students.
I don't know.
Well, if that's the case, surely the place to be dealing with that is by
the
courts.
Police.
Yeah, the police.
Yeah, okay.
So why should the police refer him for psychiatric treatment? Is it really the role of the psychiatric profession to say, don't worry, we'll give him some lithium and he'll be right?
Yeah.
And
because that would be what? Pedophilia? How young are the students? That would be...
That's right.
So that would be like a crime.
And if he
crime.
Physically assaulted the principal, then he should be charged for physical assault.
Yeah.
Now that's really what Thomas Sasse's argument is.
Yeah.
And even though I don't agree with the Scientologists, I do agree that we're talking about the insanity defense.
Mm.
And the problem for the person who pleads the insanity defense as well is that it's a two-edged sword. It means that he's forever
It doesn't matter.
Anyway, so I'll read on. Mood elevation or elation usually has a rapid onset over days. Do you think I had a rapid onset of my mood elation or elevation over a few days?
You're always a happy person, I thought. Pretty jolly guy.
So you didn't think I was more elevated?
I think you were more excited, probably, yeah.
Yeah, okay.
And, yeah.
I was.
Yeah.
It may be preceded by depressive syndrome and can be precipitated by antidepressant therapy. Mood elevation care.
Yes.
The patient reports feeling unusually happy about current circumstances. Yeah. What seemed ordinary assumes an abnormal degree of importance, and the sense of self becomes inflated. Patients regard themselves as unusually gifted and talented.
There's nothing wrong with that.
Brackets, grandiosity. The euphoric mood is infectious. But if their wishes are thwarted, they often become irritable and aggressive. Did you see me getting irritable and aggressive?
I saw you getting irritable.
Irritated or irritable?
Irritated.
That's a big difference.
Yeah.
If I have reason to be irritated, justifiable irritation is irritation. Irritable is where you're in an irritable mood.
Yeah, it depends also, like they say aggressive, and I think aggressive is a word where, you know, it's a bit dangerous to use.
It's not, it means that it's unprovoked, if it's aggressive.
Unprovoked, okay.
If you're defending yourself, I don't regard it as aggressive. Oh. But mind you, I'm not a person who hits people, right?
No, that's what I mean. You can be aggressive in your tone, you can be aggressive in...
I wasn't aggressive in my tone, do you think? At that time?
No.
Yeah? Okay. They won't use the word like extremely. They are excessively energetic.
Yeah.
Hyperactive and have a reduced need for sleep.
Yeah.
Speech is rapid, loud and pressured, with jokes, puns and plays on words.
Sounds like fun.
In more severe cases, the rate of word production is so accelerated that an almost continuous flow of ideas, jumping from one thought to the next, may occur. Brackets, flight of ideas. Now, he said I have mild flight of ideas.
Yeah.
I didn't have flight of ideas by that token at all.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I had an expansive mood, I think, if you want to call it a mood. Speech may become incomprehensible. Obviously, mine was not. Judgment is severely impaired, and social consequences can be devastating. Patients spending excessively, driving recklessly, involving themselves in silly business decisions, and performing sexual indiscretions.
Goodness me. Surely there's, you know, personal, someone's personal life, you know, choose what they want to do.
Delusions such as belief of extraordinary power.
Freedoms, really?
Sorry?
Well, it's like it's taking away freedoms. If somebody wants to go and spend a whole lot of money on something, what's wrong with that?
Well,
if
how about,
wants
you know,
to,
well, why
explore
why then?
Their sexuality, well, what's wrong with that?
Why indeed have they not taken all these guys from the big banks who overspent billions of dollars? Why have they not taken them all and put them on lithium? Why haven't they gone to the stock market where people are standing there shouting and waving their arms about all on top of each other? Why haven't they taken them all in a big truck and put them
you
into a psychiatric hospital?
You could go a step further and say...
Parliament.
Exactly. Look at the economy right this very minute. We're spending money we don't have.
Yeah.
Is that considered...
Delusions such as belief of extraordinary power or hallucinations, like hearing God telling them of a special mission, occur in severe states, which I didn't have. These symptoms improve rapidly with resolution of the mood disturbance. Occasionally, mixed affective states occur with features of both depression and mania in the same episode. Typically, patients have lowered mood but are grandiose and hyperactive with flight of ideas. And So basically, that's what I was labeled, an elevated mode. I will just, if I may, skip to... Because this is also, this is 1995. It's amazing how many, when the DSM was published in 1994, how in 1994, 1995, next immediately afterwards, there are a plethora of books pushing various drugs, the whole pharmaceutical industry, like Janssen Select. Books beyond Prozac and so on. They all coincided with an opportunity to market it from the DSM. What did you want to ask me?
The
marketing, I expect that now that they've come up with their DSM-5, the same thing is going to happen again, because I don't think really people woke up to this medicalization, pathologization of normal behavior. But now when they're talking about, I think they'll get away with an internet addiction disorder, but I don't think that they'll get away with some of those things about relationships and, you know, like bitterness, attachment disorder, whatever it is. Well, I think merely the fact that the Murdoch newspaper is actually writing it's got a thing that's effectively, and it's not scientifically denouncing it, but it's socially denouncing it.
I'm surprised it wasn't. What about like a television addiction disorder? I mean, if you're going to have an internet disorder.
Why didn't they have television addiction disorder? It's a very, very good question. Good question, because, and also the fact that nobody questioned, even though people were asking, lots of pediatricians and psychologists were asking, could television have something to do with this attention difficulty that children are having, if indeed they are having one?
Yeah.
And the psychiatrists were insisted, no, this is a chemical disorder, because see, the chemicals which are stimulant drugs that stimulate dopamine work, and therefore it can't have anything to do with these environmental factors. This is a genetic thing. People who are really pushing this was actually Murdoch, and Murdoch's, especially HarperCollins. There are lots of HarperCollins publications pushing this. So I did find it particularly interesting that this is also a Murdoch publication in 2009 that's actually asking some questions that should have been asked in 1994 when they came out with their DSM-4, because it was just as ridiculous. Especially when you look at the symptoms for elevated mood. Because you're talking about happy people. And also unusual thoughts, which I've talked about in the past.
Yeah. But I also find it interesting, if I may just go somewhere.
Yeah? Can you feel me?
No, don't feel me.
Just for a brief moment.
Say that, like with attention deficit disorder, I recalled reading that if you know a child is fidgety or can't sit still and watch something on the television, that's considered to be a sign of attention deficit
disorder. You're getting restless while watching television, yes.
Restless whilst watching television.
Suggests that television is actually a normal part of behaviour, in fact, a desirable part of behaviour.
Yeah. And then, now, like, we know that television has a hypnotic effect, just as does the internet. And it's quite easily, like, it draws you in, like, visual, music,
They use every hypnotic trick in the book.
Yeah. So, I mean...
So there should be television addiction disorder as well, you're saying, or what?
I'm not saying... I don't think it's a disorder. I think it's obviously intentional. Like, their television is distracting in that, like, there's advertising on television, there's advertising on the internet, there's agendas. So,
people selling things.
Yeah.
What is your experience? Because you've got some experience with attention deficit disorder, children or children who have been diagnosed with it.
A few.
And what is your feeling about it? Do you think the label is useful, and what do you think is the effect of the drugs yourself?
Not at all. I don't think the label is at all useful. I think the label is debilitating, if I can use that word.
Yeah. Why do you think it's debilitating? How does it affect children adversely?
Well, it's the label creates a judgment of how that child is perceived by others.
Stigmatization, you mean? They get stigmatized?
Yeah. So they're considered to have, be there's something wrong with them.
So they get blamed. When other things, do you think they get blamed by when something goes wrong in the family, or
they could be scapegoated?
You get scapegoated,
time. And also, you know, maybe, you know, I have seen when these particular children have had an emotional reaction to something, that then, you know, the drug comes out.
He
hasn't had his medication, or he's probably wearing off, or that kind of thing. And the medication is the.
And this is in childcare centres.
No, this is more so
in schools, primary schools.
Well, this was my most experience with kids who have been diagnosed with ADHD has been in special school.
No, it's okay.
You know, they're all individual children.
Alright. And do you think that this your experience with these children who have had this label, I mean, I know that they're not hundreds of children, but do you think that they are actually having difficulty with their ability to concentrate? Or do you think do you think they can be engaged in things that they're interested in?
Of course.
All right. But there must be naughty children as well.
Yeah, some of them have got what you would call, I suppose, as like, you know, maybe if display more often
behavioral.
Yeah. difficulties, I suppose. Like, maybe they'll react more strongly to a situation, or, you know, maybe their emotions are more.
Sure, intense.
You do get some children who are more active, who want to be running around, or rather than sitting down at a particular time. I don't see that as really as an illness.
And where do you think naughtiness comes into it?
Well, this is the thing. I mean, you have a system where it's considered to be normal to be sitting down most of the day from 5 years on, 5 year olds onwards, really, and even before that in kindergarten, where it's supposed to be normal for a child to be sitting and learning in a particular style and setting from 9 to 3:30 with what, a half an hour break in between and then an hour break for play at lunch. And that's supposed to be what is considered normal.
Why do you think then they want to go and sit there staring at a screen when they come home?
Who?
Children.
Some of them do, some of them don't.
Yeah. No, well, apparently, I mean, that is something that, I mean, I think that
it's
maybe
like
they just don't know how to entertain themselves.
Well, there's that.
Yeah.
There's that, and it's also, maybe it's like the same reason why people who work from 9 to 5 come home and switch on the box.
They're tired.
They're brain numbed.
Yeah.
They just want a veg and it provides a tool that is going to entertain you.
Okay.
Rather than you entertain yourself, I suppose.
Nice, yeah.